Welcome to the session. So if you remember in the last class, we are discussing about the different types of policy instrument like command and control based policy instrument and market based policy instrument, and also we discuss about the different kind of emission trading, and we saw mostly about details about the two market based instrument what are being existing in India. One is PAT, that is perform achievement trade, and second one is REC. And also beyond that also we have seen what are the challenges and opportunity when we go for the market based instrument mostly in the developing economy. Now in this session we will see what are the different environmental law that is existing in India. Mostly I have picked up only those, there are many more laws, but I have picked few to give you understanding that what are the different acts, what are the different laws that is existing in India with respect to environment, and also how the disclosure regulation started and what are the changes or what are the improvement or what are the revision that has happened to the disclosure regulation. So to start with, let's start that what is environmental law in India, what are the different environmental law in India. So we all know that MOEF is the apex body, typically the responsible authority in the country for regulating and ensuring environmental protection. It lays down the legal and regulatory framework for the same, and they have also put up the environmental legislation. MOEF and also Pollution Control Board together, they form the regulatory and the administrative core of the sector. So in the central, you will find the Central Pollution Control Board, that is overall for the country, and different state, we have the State Pollution Control Board with respect to the activities related to the state. So in 2014, there was a change that happened with respect to this functioning of MOEF. So although MOEF was looking into the climate change activity, it's the reduction in the climate change activity, different intervention responses, but in 2014 that there was a priority by MOEF for the tackling the climate change. And that point of time the ministry was renamed as Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change. In the short form it is known as MOEF's CC. Now the first act what we'll discuss is that National Green Tribunal Act 2010. This is typically or popularly known as the NGT Act, and it is being enacted with the objective to provide the establishment of National Green Tribunal, that is NGT. And why this NGT was established? For effective and expeditious disposal of cases relating to environmental protection and conservation of forest. Also, it takes care of the other natural resources including enforcement of any legal rights relating to environment, giving relief, compensation of for damage to person, property for matters connected to therewith and incidentally thereto. And the basis of this National Green Tribunal Act or NGT, it is based on the doctrine of sustainable development. The precautionary principle and polluter pays principle explicitly embedded in case of NGT Act. Then we have the AIR Act. So if you ask possibly the two act what everybody knows about the environment is, one is AIR Act and second one is the Water Act. So this AIR Act is, this is related to air prevention and prevention and control of pollution act pollution. It is 1981, it is known as AIR Act. This is to provide prevention, control and abatement of air pollution, and for the establishment of boards at the central and state level with a view to carry out whatever the objective, that is to provide prevention, control and abatement of the air pollution. Then we have Water Act, that is in 1974, and this is being enacted to provide the prevention and control of the water pollution and to maintain and restore wholesomeness of water in the country. It provides establishment of board for the prevention and control of water pollution with a view to carrying out the efforts and purpose. and also it prohibits the discharge of pollutants into the water body beyond a given standard, lays down the penalty for the non-compliance. So, if you remember at some point of time when we are discussing a case with respect to the discharge to the water, so under this Water Act, the reference to that over here is that typically under Water Act, the Central Pollution Control Board, they give that whatever the dischargeable limit for the water pollutant when the wastewater get into the nearest water bodies or to the open water body, like what should be the limit for BOD, what is the limit for COD and what is the limit for TSS. Then we have EPA, that is Environment Protection Act in 1986 started. It provides the protection and improvement for the environment, and it is established preparing a framework for studying, planning, implementing long term requirement of the environmental safety. It lays down the system of speedy, adequate response to the situation threatening of the environment. And this is an umbrella legislation designated to provide the framework of coordination of all central and state authority established under Water Act and Air Act. Then we have Hazardous Waste Management Rule, and it is in 2008, and the first one is the Hazardous Waste Rule, which brought out in 2008. And it provides a guide for manufacture, storage, import of the hazardous chemical and for management of the hazardous waste. Then for biomedical waste, the rule was in 1998 which talks about the proper disposal, desegregation and transport of the infectious waste. And municipal solid waste rules, that is in 2000, it aims at municipality to dispose the municipal solid waste in the scientific manner. Similarly, waste rule in 2011, and the primary objective is to reduce the hazardous substance in electrical and electronic equipment, and by specifying threshold for the use of the hazardous material and to channelize the e-waste generated in the country for environmentally sound recycling. And there is one correction over here, I think the E is missing over here, it should be e-waste management handling rule in 2011. The rules apply to every producer, consumer or bulk consumer, collection center, dismantler and recycler of the e-waste, and it involves the manufacture, sell, purchase, processing of the electrical and electronic equipment or the component as per detail the rule. Then there is a waste management rule for battery, that is 2001, deal with proper and effective management of handling of lead acid battery waste. Requires all manufacturer, assembler and reconditioner and all other stakeholder to about sale, purchase and use of battery component, that what should be the guideline or what are the guideline for the battery rule, they have to follow this. And the most recent rule with respect to this hazardous waste is the plastic waste management rule in 2016, which increased the minimum thickness of plastic carry bag from 40 to 50 micron and stipulate the minimum thickness of 50 micron for plastic sheet and also facilitate the collection and recycling of the plastic waste. So, if you look at the entire waste management regulation, they play a very important role in the circular economy, because if you look at the transition now happening from the linear economy to the circular economy, and one of the important component where we need proper regulation, where we need proper intervention and also better practice, improve practices, because that is a important component to lead to the circular economic practices. Then let us see what is happening in the disclosure regulation in India. So, in 2012, SEBI, they mandated the top 100 listed entities by the market capitalization to file the business responsibility report as per the disclosure requirement. So, this is based on the National Voluntary Guideline on Social, Environmental and Economic Responsibility of Business, popularly known as NVGs. And after 2012, so it was in 2012, there is the top 100 listed, they were supposed to file the business responsibility report. It was changed in 2019, MCA revised the NVG and formulated the National Guideline on Responsible Business Conduct, which is known as NGRBC. And in December 2019, SEBI extended the business responsibility report requirement from top 100 to top 1000 listed entity by market capitalization for the financial year 2019-20. Then the most recent changes what has happened with respect to disclosure is that it introduced the new requirement of business sustainability reporting for by the listed entity, and the it is not only business responsibility report, now it is called as business responsibility and sustainability report, that is BRSR, will replace the existing business responsibility report, and the focus is ESG perspective, and it is intended to enable businesses to engage more meaningfully with their stakeholder. It will encourage business to go beyond the regulatory financial compliance and report on their social and environmental impact. So this is applicable to top 1000 listed company by market capitalization for reporting, and this will be voluntary, on voluntary basis preparing or producing this report in 2021-22, but it would be mandatory from the financial year 22 and 23. So in this session we discuss, in the previous session we discuss about the market based, like little bit summary on the market based instrument, and in this session we discuss about the environmental laws in India, the different laws what are applicable, and also few of them what we have discussed in detail, and also we discuss about the disclosure regulation. Thank you.